If notoriety and the immediate spotlight of public attention is what the Carlisle gang desired, they certainly received it in spades. Outlaws of their ilk were generally given somewhat of a Robin Hood status. However, with the death of Susie Sharp and the injuries sustained by the others in the car, especially that of six-year-old Troy, public sentiment soured towards the gang. Oklahoma Governor William Murray admonished the acts of the Carlisle gang, yet refused to send in the Oklahoma National Guard to aid in the pursuit of the outlaws. The Oklahoma National Guard did donate some personnel, tear gas, automatic rifles, and phosphorus grenades to the ever-growing posse, which had swollen to over 100 men. The lawmen in charge were Muskogee County Sheriff V.S. Cannon and Cherokee County Sheriff Jim Sog Sanders. The posse consisted of officers of both counties, Rogers County, Sequoia County, volunteers and reserve officers, the Muskogee Police Department, and the Tahlequah Police Department. Witnesses indicated Luther Jolliffe, who was out on a $1,000 bond in connection with a whiskey charge, had several men in his car and had bought 12 hamburgers at a Weber's Falls cafe the day of the Sharp killing. Although Jolliffe refused to divulge the identities of his passengers, Cannon and Sanders felt certain that these were the Sharp killers. During the investigation of the insurance salesman's car that the gang had crashed near the bottom of Bragg's Mountain, a bag of shotgun shells, a half-empty jug of moonshine, and bloodstains were found inside. Cannon and Sanders both felt the gang was planning a possible bank robbery. A $200 reward for information leading to the arrest of the suspects was posted by the Muskogee County Sheriff's Department. On September 4th, the car stolen from the Boy Scout group was found abandoned near Fort Gibson, Oklahoma, in Muskogee County. After interviewing a number of witnesses, including the Sharps, Cannon and Sanders felt they had their suspects. Kai Carlisle, Troy Love, Ford Bradshaw, Eddie Clanton, and Jim Binge. The manhunt was broken into several units, scouring the Cookson area of the Illinois River. Some of these areas are now underwater with the creation of Lake Tenkiller, which began in 1947. The following weeks saw the gang slip through the fingers of the posse time and time again, until an informant gave law enforcement one heck of a lead. Of course, like so many situations in this story, there are two accounts of what happened. Bud McLean, a farmer from Barber in his late 20s, received a letter from Kai Carlisle asking McLean to drive to Pinedale, Arkansas to retrieve him and Troy Love. The other version is that Carlisle and his gang were coming to McLean's home and needed to be driven to a relative's home. One thing that's not disputed is that McLean was illiterate and needed the letter to be read to him. The man who read the letter to McLean turned informant and alerted law enforcement. Later that evening, two roadblocks were set up. The northern roadblock consisted of Deputy Sheriff Grover Bishop, Muskogee County Sheriff Cannon, Muskogee County Deputy Sheriff Corgan, and a few other unnamed law enforcement officials. The southern roadblock was manned by Muskogee County Deputy Sheriff Webster Reese, Muskogee County Officer Ray Crinklaw, Tahlequah City Policeman Frank Edwards, and Special Deputy with the Muskogee County Sheriff's Department, Tom Cook.
Sometime around 4 in the morning, they observed a vehicle headed their way. Once the vehicle got near the ambush site, it was too late for the vehicle to turn around or go in another direction. One of the deputies was able to set up a point where he was the first person to make contact with the Carlisle gang. When the vehicle got to a spot where they know they couldn't get around, Troy Love was apparently the first one out of the car and he started shooting at the deputies.
Troy Love was known as a crack shot, and so he fired several rounds at the posse, striking a few of the deputies, one in the gut, one in the mouth and shoulder.
The deputy from Muskogee County was killed instantly. Frank Edwards sustained injuries to his neck, and he lived, but he died a short term later of pneumonia.
A gunfight ensued where several shots were fired back and forth between the Carlisle gang and the deputies.
And then they believe three of them escaped into the woods. And there's been several different stories over that. Troy Love from the woods laid a whole bunch of fire at the deputies, causing them to retreat, which allowed Troy Love, Kai Carlisle, and the other to escape. Or the other thing is they just escaped into the woods while other law enforcement were firing at them. But nonetheless, the three of them got away. Bud McLean was the driver, and when they looked into the vehicle, he was, of course, shot to death.
Before we move on, let's backtrack just a bit. Earlier, Bishop said this in an audio recording.
Which one was it that you killed?
Kai and Paul and Buddy.
Unless Bishop had figured out some way to be at two places at the same time, and no written history has attested to Bishop being part of the Southern roadblock, it seems more than logical that Bishop did not shoot Bud McLean. September 18, 1932, began with the burial of Muskogee County Officer Webster Reese, Tahlequah City Officer Frank Edwards in a hospital room, convalescing from wounds that would lead to his death, and ended with the lifeless bodies of Kai Carlisle and Troy Love on the lawn of Reed Culver Funeral Home in Tahlequah.
On the 18th of September, another ambush was set up near the Carter family property.
They knew Dick had something to do with Kai and Troy because the pistol that was found in the car with McLean had Dick Carter's initials carved into it, DC, and they had seen that gun before. The sheriff's office had had it for some reason, whether they had impounded it or taken it away from him and given it back. So they knew who owned that gun. So they got a hold of Dick Carter, knowing he had either given him the gun or had been in close proximity to him for them to steal it from him.
So they set up and saw two women coming out of the house carrying food. It's believed the women spotted Grover Bishop, and the food and everything they had, they dumped it out for the hogs. Grover Bishop was known to be a little heavy-handed, but he needed to get the information he needed to find Kai Carlisle and Troy Love. Whether he threatened to hang Dick Carter on the spot or whether he just convinced him to tell the truth, ultimately Dick Carter told them where he was hiding out.
Apparently at that time they'd located Carlisle and Troy Love in a thicket. This time Grover Bishop and several others were there at that particular site.
And Kai and Troy were very close friends, and so it's believed that Kai was injured pretty badly, but Troy wouldn't leave his side. He was going to stay with him.
They had made the plan, Grover, along with the other deputies from several counties. I think there was even National Guardsmen that were with them, that they were going to split up. I've read 28, somewhere around just under 30 officers. Knowing where this thicket was, one-third of them, roughly, was going to come in head on to it, and the other two groups would come from sides, and they were going to push them into an open area.
They got Kai and Troy basically in a crossfire situation. They left one avenue of retreat, you know, whereas that's where they knew that they could flush them out and have a clear line of sight.
Obviously, they're given the opportunity to, all you got to do is say, hey, I give up, and drop your gun. One of the officers, as he was approaching, a young guy, said, let's go get them, guys, yells out and takes a bullet through the heart and drops dead right there.
In the ensuing gunfight, Kai Carlisle was apparently shot numerous times.
Kai Carlisle was struck and shot down, and shortly thereafter, Troy Love tried to make a run for it. He made it about 100 yards before he was shot down by the posse.
They went out blazing, allegedly, from things that I've read and people I've talked to. They ran out of bullets. They shot everything they had. Did they deserve it? I'm sure they fired the first round and killed an officer just seconds before this, before their own demise. They knew what was coming. I think they felt there wasn't any other way out of this. And they knew what they had done. They knew they'd killed other officers. They knew they'd killed this other lady. And Kyle was a twice escapee. He was an escapee from McAllister, and he was an escapee from Little Rock with Troy Love. Probably wasn't going to be easy on him. If they went back to prison somewhere, it was probably going to be pretty torturous. Even though they had done some very bad things, I think they knew the end was coming, and that was what that's what they wanted. And I think that's what Grover and the other deputies, they've watched multiple deputies get killed, men that have volunteered their time, had families, volunteered from different cities.
Now, the story goes, and this is, again, it's an oral history version, which has through time proved most likely accurate. Grover Bishop loaded up the bodies of Carlisle and Troy Love into the back of his vehicle.
Of course, stories say that the legs were hanging out and they were dragging the ground. Some just say they were in the back of the car.
And he drove the bodies back from the Barber Cookson area into Tahlequah in Cherokee County and laid the bodies on the property of Reed Culver Funeral Home, where they were eventually examined by the medical examiner.
So my great-grandfather, Ed Carlisle, and some of his brothers came to town, went to the sheriff's office and retrieved the firearms and other personal belongings that the Carlisle and Troy Love gang had on them at the time of their death. In that, my grandfather was able to retrieve this pistol. Some of the other uncles, I think, had got a 45-70 rifle, and I've heard a shotgun. No idea what make or model. Those have gone with other family members down the road. This gun came back to my dad. My great-grandfather had loaned it to a lady that lived here in town that was scared of somebody that had been bothering her. So when she died, her family gave it, called my dad, because my dad was the oldest living relative of Ed Carlos, because it was Ed's property now. And my dad said he wanted me to have it so it could be passed on, talked about, shown to people. My father's 82 at this time, and he's not going to drag the gun out and show it to people. And you can tell it's old. It's a Chicago Firearms Company pistol, which if it's truly made by Chicago Firearms, it was around 1892 to about 1895 or 96. That company went defunct, and a company called Merle bought out the name Chicago Firearms and then started making it under that same name. I guess they had a little bit of a reputation, and they made it for about 6 years. Somewhere around 1905, the pistol was no longer produced, which gives it prominence as to the date. You know, Kai Carlisle probably, you know, it was an old used gun at that time. It sold for $1.96 in a catalog when it was new. Even then, which, you know, is cheap, but by today's standard, it's probably, you know, $100 gun or less even today. So it wasn't the best gun, but that's what these guys could pick up. It was probably traded to somebody, maybe lost or won in a poker game. It's got wooden grips on it that are not factory. They appear to be hand carved. How those grips got changed, back then you couldn't just order a new set of grips from a catalog. So somebody sat down for hours with a pocket knife or a saw and whittled out new grips that they could put on this gun.
Andrew McGinnis was the man slain at the outset of the standoff. McGinnis was a special deputy with Muskogee County Sheriff's Department. He left behind a wife and 5 children. Also killed in the exchange of gunfire was Rogers County Officer James Hurt Flippin. Flippin died the following morning from blood loss. The death toll was capped at 8.
So in early 2000, I was working for the police department in Tahlequah, and Chief Norman Fisher contacted me and told me that asked me if I would go to Oklahoma City to recognize a fallen police officer that they was actually going to recognize and put on the memorial up there. And his name was Frank Edwards. I was able to introduce him to other law enforcement officers at the memorial in Oklahoma City, and now his name is etched in the memorial in Oklahoma City. But fast forward, I'm now the fire chief, and we was doing research at the fire department. And doing research, we have family members that come in all the time that basically says, you know, my grandpa, my great-grandpa was a firefighter, you know, and we have archive books down there that we can go in and kind of look for names, different things. And as we were looking, we come across Frank Edwards, the date when he died. It even has minutes and different things, and I'll read you some. Frank Edwards, he started with the fire department in Tahlequah on May 3rd of 1926. And if you go over, it says, you know, date of retirement, which here it's marked death, 10/25 of 32. Tahlequah Fire Department meeting in regular session with 15 members present. Motion made by Sid Beam, Secretary H.H. Yeager, that Frank Edwards be credited with service of time and let the record show. I just thought it was pretty interesting that, you know, that the one that found it was me, you know, being from law enforcement and the fire service, that I think it was only fitting that I found that. From my knowledge and from going to the memorial, Frank Edwards is the only municipal police officer in Tahlequah that was killed in the line of duty.
Taking into consideration Bishop's World War I record and the bloodshed that surrounded him, and the numerous violent entanglements his law enforcement career had put him in, it's nothing short of a miracle that Bishop, up to that point, had remained relatively unscathed. However, one night in northern Cherokee County, Bishop was reminded that he too was human.
One of our interviews with John Willie Nichols. John Willie Nichols was Grover Bishop's undersheriff, and he lived between Peggs and Holbert, Oklahoma. We went to his house numerous times, and one of the stories he told us about Grover was that there was a man that was a wanted man, a red-headed guy, now the way John Willie described him, big red-headed man that lived off Peggs Road. Grover had been issued or given from the state a pair of 9mm Lugers pistols. And he was wearing them that day, and Grover went after him, and it was getting dark.
For reasons unknown, Bishop decided not to identify himself as a law enforcement official. Instead, gave a different name when the outlaw asked who was outside.
This man said, "I don't believe you're him," and shot Grover. Wounding Grover, I believe he said with a shotgun, wounding Grover in the right arm, and Grover pulled his left gun, the pistol he carried on his left side as well as his right side, and shot and killed this man. That was from John Willie Nichols' report. He was Grover's undersheriff at that time.
And once again, Deputy Sheriff Grover Bishop was making headlines. The North Cherokee County shootout was front page news across the country. The outlaw in question was identified as Claude Claxton. Oral history differs somewhat from the written. The newspapers reported Bishop using a revolver, whereas oral history has Bishop using a Luger. But in all fairness, sometimes the paper doesn't get it right. Additionally, Bishop was known to carry Lugers while on duty. The only other glaring difference was Bishop being shot in the hand and only having use of one hand during the shootout. In 1933, Bishop gained national recognition with the Public Hero No. 1 Award for Heroism and Valor by the Gangbuster radio program. Considering television was almost two decades away, Radio was the biggest stage in the nation.
And now, Gangbusters! Gangbusters, presented in cooperation with police and federal law enforcement departments throughout the United States. The only national program that brings you authentic police case histories.
Bishop's legend was growing. ...1935 saw Bishop win the Democratic nomination for Cherokee County Sheriff. Bishop later wrapped up the win with a general election victory. Deputy Bishop was now Sheriff Bishop, the highest law enforcement position in the county. Although his annual budget was small, even by today's standards, Bishop was free and clear to run the department as he saw fit. Unlike today, where county elections are every 4 years... Back then, elections were every 2 years. Two-year posts have been described as winning an election just to start campaigning again. But as long as Bishop kept the confidence of the voting public, he could expect a successful re-election campaign every 2 years. In Cherokee County, the repeal of Prohibition in 1933 did little to curb bootlegging. Moreover, the country was still in the midst of the Great Depression, which continued to fuel nationwide crime sprees. This meant there were plenty of bad guys to get. Of course, Bishop's way of getting bad guys certainly seemed to differ from his predecessors.
It's hard for me to imagine how these guys operated back in the 30s. You know, today when we go on a call, we have three or four deputies that go together. And they're always in constant contact with each other. They're always in constant contact with our dispatch. They've got radios in their cars. They've got radios that they carry on their belts. They've got cell phones. You know, back then, Sheriff Bishop didn't have that. He didn't have backup. He didn't have the technology of cell phones and radios or telephone. Pretty much all he had was a gun and a car and himself. So when he left the office to go on a call, he was on his own until he got back. Very dangerous. Of course, times were more dangerous back then.
Now, folks need to remember back then that times were tough in Cherokee County. Folks were hungry. And a lot of times folks committed crimes just to survive, just to stay alive and put food on the table. And it wasn't always the case that law enforcement always had the benefit of cooperation with the citizenry. Back then, a lot of times the folks out in the country stood with the outlaws against the government. And they did that because those were the individuals that they knew. And a lot of times they saw government as that could be the enemy for their way of life.
You know, it's just hard for me to wrap my head around how he went about every day doing his job that was so much different than the way we do it today. We were a very rural county, a very rural area back then. You know, we still are now to an extent, but you know, he might drive to an area and have to walk on foot to a house, and that could be several miles away. It was a lot more physical back then than it is today. I would imagine he spent a lot of time on his feet in the woods, in creek beds, climbing mountains, climbing hills. He just didn't have the luxuries that we have today. I never met Sheriff Bishop, so a lot of the stories that I've heard over the years are they've been passed down from deputy to new deputy, just passed down the line. Legends. So I've never seen any documentation on any of his cases as far as written reports or anything like that. What I hear is that he killed in the line of duty between 5 and 17 people. That seems really high for nowadays.
He liked to get his man at all costs.
But I've never heard anything that led me to believe that he was just going out and killing people for no reason. It was in the line of duty to protect himself and others.
In modern days now, when a sheriff or a deputy sheriff uses deadly force against a criminal, as the district attorney, I am required to review that to make a determination as to whether or not that law enforcement officer acted justifiably under the law. Now, from some of the stories that I've read, understanding the early history of Cherokee County and the outlaw type ways out in the country, I think that quite a few of the stories I've heard could also be justified now, but some of them sure are questionable. I'll say that.
I've heard stories about shootouts where he ended up killing suspects. He loaded them either in the back of his car or on the front of his car, drove them to town and dumped them off in the funeral home yard. That sounds like something that, to me today, that is really far-fetched for a lot of people to believe. But knowing what I know and hearing these stories passed down from people that I trust, I believe that was probably pretty close to being true. It's just fun to listen to stuff like that.
So in modern days, the district attorney works hand in hand with the Cherokee County Sheriff. We investigate and work on cases together. And I imagine it was like that back in the old days, back after World War I here in Cherokee County.
When I was a new law enforcement officer, that there was county law and that there's statute law. And the difference in county law and statute laws are enacted by the legislator. They're written down in a book somewhere. County law is what are laws that are accepted in your area. And most of them are enforced by the people that come up with the laws, like the sheriff of in the 30s. I would imagine that Sheriff Bishop worked a lot off of county law, the way he thought things should be run, the way he thought things should be done, and didn't more than likely pay that close attention to what the statutes and the legislative laws were.
Now, in the days of Sheriff Bishop, I think law enforcement may have been a little bit different. And it's possible that maybe there wasn't the type of safeguards to stop a sheriff, maybe from taking the law into his own hands like they are today.
Much different than what we would do today or what we could get away with today.
I can imagine as DA, thinking back to that time, it would have been a little difficult to keep Sheriff Bishop following the law.
He didn't go to the training that we go to nowadays. He didn't go to the continuing education that we have to go to nowadays. More than likely, he wasn't trained at all. He was probably trained by the sheriff that hired him as a deputy, and that was it. And I would imagine there wasn't a lot of legal block training in that. So more than likely, he probably had no idea what many of the laws that he was enforcing were. He went with what he knew, what was right and what was wrong. But that's just my theory.
The Tommy gun. 45 caliber bullets, 1,500 bullets a minute. Helping our men of law enforcement take the fight to the criminals. And if you don't believe me, just ask Sheriff Grover Bishop.
Well, Beck, the stories we've heard or what we've been told from these documents that I've looked through, apparently back in the early 30s, A lot of the law enforcement agencies in Oklahoma were issued Tommy guns. And I guess the reason was all the outlaws back then had had Tommy guns, and the law enforcement was outgunned back then. So one of the Tommy guns that was issued to Sequoia County Sheriff's Office back in June of 1933. And we've found all the old original documents, and we still have the gun here at our sheriff's office. It's still in operation, and we even take it out and shoot it once in a while. It's a pretty neat old gun. It was Sheriff Bill Byrd back in 1933 that this gun was originally issued to. This gun, it's a 1921 model Thompson submachine gun. It shoots 45 caliber ammo. It's a very heavy gun. Yeah, I couldn't imagine having to carry this around while you worked back then, but very heavy. It's very hard to shoot. It's very hard to control. But they apparently they all had to have them to be able to match firearms with the outlaws of those days. One of our former sheriffs, E.W. Floyd, was actually the brother of a famous outlaw, Pretty Boy Floyd, who lived here in Sequoia County, up in the Marble City area. Stories about this Tommy gun. It was originally thought that this was either Pretty Boy Floyd's gun or somebody in his gang, but after we tracked down the serial number and got with Thompson Center, we found where it was originally issued to the sheriff's office was the true story about this gun.
Perhaps the ending of World War II and the rebuilding of the nation had an effect. Or maybe the citizens of Cherokee County felt that it was time to shift away from Bishop's heavy-handed approach to law enforcement. Whatever the case, Bishop was defeated in the 1945 Democratic primary by Bill Thorne. The reign of the gang-busting, Tommy gun-toting sheriff had come to an unexpected end. After his years of capturing stills and hunting down outlaws with his unique brand of no-nonsense law enforcement, Bishop retired to his Sellers property to raise crops and cattle. For this chapter of his life to have any level of success, he knew he'd need help. Bishop's young neighbor, Yott Young, eager for work, was hired on to help out at Bishop's rural estate.
Well, I started to work for Rover Bishop in late 40s or middle 40s, and worked for him about 2 years or three, and helped do everything. We built fence, we cleared land, anything that he just moved here and was getting his farming ready, and very good neighbor. If you didn't cross him, he was a very good neighbor. Do anything for you. He would even let you know when the feds was coming if he's making whiskey. And he'd warn you. But he was, that's just the way he was, you know. If he was, he knew people back in the Depression, they had to do something for make their family a living, you know. And he didn't bother people like that, but it was them people that thought they was bad outlaws and people that done all that kind of stuff. He was, he brought them under the gun, you know, and that was the way he was. But he was a very kind man, and I was just a teenager when I worked for him, and and I also worked for his brother-in-law, which was Jimmy Carlisle. And Jimmy Carlisle, he told Grover, he said, this old young boy, he's worth three guys. That I had about 20 head of yearlings to brand and castrate. And he said, I was going to hire three more hands. And he said, me and you can do it. We branded them cows. He held them all by himself, and I cut them and branded them. And he told Grover, and then Grover told me, he said, well, if that tight wad do that, I was working 50 cents a day, and then he'd give me a dollar a day. And Grover says, if that tight wad can give you a dollar a day, he said, I'll give you a dollar a day, too. We cleared that land, and Grover found a skunk den, he says, and he wanted me to look at it, and I looked at it. I said, Grover, that ain't no skunk den. Yeah, that's a skunk den, he said. I said, I don't see a skunk hair around here. I said, that's a rattlesnake den. He said, skunks don't shed in the wintertime. He said, they ain't got no hair coming out. So he went on and plowed the ground up, planted his corn, and one of them rattlesnakes bit him on the leg while he was plowing that corn. And then the next winter, he come down and got me and said, I want you to help me. What are we going to do? I'll tell you when we get there. And we went back to the rattlesnake den, and he had a long, stiff wire and three sticks of dynamite taped to it, and about a 100-foot roll of fuse. And he just unrolled the fuse as he pushed the wire in there, and got it in there, and he lit that thing, and we took off to the creek and got behind the bank, and that whole hillside blowed up. When it finally got down there, and we didn't see a rattlesnake, but he got them all. The war couldn't kill him, and the people couldn't kill him, and the rattlesnakes couldn't kill him. So he was a tough old man.
Outside of the occasional trip to Tahlequah, Bishop's duties at his Sellers Mission farm kept him out of the public eye. However, the former gang-busting sheriff would once again garner front-page attention. In August of 1958, the hunter became the hunted, as Bishop found himself formally charged with murder in a 12-person jury trial that followed. Bishop's ongoing feud with the neighboring Ryder family escalated to bloodshed. Like so many of Bishop's escapades, there are various oral history accounts of the events that transpired on the morning of August 1st, 1958.
There were some neighbors moved in up here about a half a mile from him, and they had it in for him for something, and their name was Ryder, Wilson Ryder. And his son, I don't remember his name, but they went over to his house and called him out and told him they was going to kill him. And they didn't know he had his gun stuck in his overall bib. And when they told him that, they reached for theirs, but he beat them. He had that gun right there ready, and he shot the old man and killed him. The boy jumped back in the car and run away, and had to protect himself, just like any other man would do. Got to protect self, and that was his motto. Either protect yourself or you're gonna die, you know.
You know, there's another story that I've been told about after Sheriff Bishop had retired. He was at home one day. Two men approached him at home that had, you know, bad intent. They confronted each other in his yard. His wife brought out two cream jugs that had his guns in them. He picked up both guns and shot and killed both the men. The truth is probably right in the middle somewhere.
The Tahlequah Star Citizen reported the events differently. It was more than obvious that Bishop and the Ryder family weren't the epitome of good neighbors living in harmony. The family patriarch, Wilson Ryder, had been a well-known cattleman in Cherokee County for quite some time, and Bishop, too, was raising cattle. The turn of events that seemed to bring the dissidence between the two families to a violent crescendo involved Wilson's sons riding their horses in such a way that Bishop's cattle were spooked, with one of Bishop's fences being damaged as a result. Just 2 days before the fatal shooting, talk around the city of Tahlequah indicated that Bishop was speaking in terms of filing charges against the Ryder clan for property damage. Bishop added to his complaints against the Ryder family by alluding to cattle rustling. However, none of the residents in that area had reported any livestock theft. At approximately 8 a.m. on the morning of August 1st, Wilson Ryder, in the presence of his son Claude, was shot by Bishop's 38 caliber German Luger. The bullet entered the left side of Ryder's chest, exiting under his right arm. When one of Ryder's sons, more than likely Claude, arrived at Tahlequah Hospital with Wilson's body, Wilson was pronounced dead on arrival. Arrested by Deputy Sheriff Willard Moss, Bishop was arraigned by Judge Bob Walker and released on $10,000 bond. At the trial in December of the same year, Bishop stated under oath that self-defense was the reason he shot Ryder. But Claude Ryder testified that Bishop had stopped their vehicle as the pair traveled to visit relatives in the area. Claude stated that his father was shot by Bishop without reason. Furthermore, during the investigation, authorities had found no weapons in the Ryder car or any evidence that either Ryder was armed at the time of the incident. However, the 9-man, 3-woman jury only took 1.5 hours to return a not guilty verdict. Wilson Ryder is buried at the Holland Cemetery in Cherokee County.
My dad knew of Grover Bishop when he was young and knew that there was a little animosity between the Carlisles, and which my dad's mother is a Carlisle, that's my grandmother, and he didn't ever know why for sure, didn't understand what had happened, but he was traveling home or somewhere down around Jensie's Cafe now. Back then it was a convenience store, a store, a general store, and it had flooded. Right there in front of the Ruckers, there's a low-water bridge, and the school bus had gotten stuck, was flooded out there. And he watched Grover, knew who he was, and watched Grover come down, swim out to the bus, and rescue every kid. Of course, the buses were not as long and big as they are now, but my dad said he put every kid around his neck and swam them in very swift, flooded waters, and rescued every kid off that bus that day. And my dad said he knew then, regardless of what the family did or didn't like about Grover, he knew he was a good man to go do that, to do something as heroic and for him to watch. Of course, my dad was only 10, 12 years old at the time, but knew even then that man had some honor about him, just to go out and risk his own life to save all those kids who he could have stood by and watched things go, you know, completely wrong. Dad knew Grover later in life when he had moved back to town and visited with Grover on quite a few occasions here in Tahlequah. So I think it helped. My dad wanted to know for himself kind of the history of Grover with our family and the Carlisles and Kai Carlisle's death and the things that had gone on. I think it put my dad's mind at ease a little bit, knowing what happened had to happen and what had, you know, what had to be done. And also that he knew he had seen him do some heroic things and kind of wanted to let him know not everybody in the family hated him.
After the passing of his wife, Carrie, in 1970, Bishop and his second wife, Lily, moved to Tahlequah. Bishop still grew vegetables and was a bit more public because of his move to town. The once action-packed life of the former lawman became more relaxed and easygoing, considering all he had experienced in his life. A bit of quiet was probably welcomed by Bishop and his wife.
All right, I met Grover Bishop back in 1975. I was a new deputy, hired on January of 1975 for the Cherokee County Sheriff's Office. Our courthouse was what is now Cherokee Nation Courthouse. And he would come in and visit with us, and I kind of got to know Grover. Grover was a tall gentleman, big in frame, probably 6'4". And probably 240 pounds, even in his older years. And he was very interesting to talk to, and that's how I first got to meet Grover. Well, at that time, he told me some stories, cases that he had to work on, how he would go out into the countryside, usually by himself. And then in 1979, we built a new courthouse and moved from the Cherokee Nation Capitol building to the new courthouse. And he'd still come in to visit with me, or just come into the sheriff's office. He looked the same as he did back in a few years earlier. And I remember one day he come in and said, "Boy," I said, "Grover, what are you thinking about?" He had a funny, kind of a strained look on his face, and he kind of shook his head and said, "Boy, I don't know how you can be a lawman today. You got too many damn laws you got to go by." I never forgot that statement he made. He said whatever had to be done, he done it. They went to jail one way or the other.
My remembrance of Mr. Bishop is when he had been retired from some time from any work with law agencies. And he and his wife, Carrie Carlisle Bishop, had always a large vegetable garden in the spring and summer. And people went to their home to buy vegetables. That was one of the ways that they helped with whatever retirement money they had. And I can remember him as just a nice old man who would visit with my mother and dad, and I went with them just to carry them around, you know, and buy corn and potatoes, tomatoes, and okra. Raised this large, just a kindly old man. I was told by my parents that in probably 1937, when we lived in Mays County in Locust Grove, where my parents had a business, that a Reverend Rutherford, who lived in the Iron Post community in Mays County, which is very close to the line into Cherokee County, was holding a tent revival somewhere on one of those dirt roads between Locust Grove and Tahlequah, close to the line, and in a brush arbor. And my parents were, mother played the piano, and I had always sung. She had taught me to sing. And this Miss Reverend Rutherford was a friend of mother and dad, and he asked if one night in the revival my mother would let me sing. And she said yes, she would. And that night she told me, she and my dad told me, that I sang a song called Oh Come Go With Me to My Father's Home. There'll Be Peace, Sweet Peace. And Grover Bishop, obviously probably sheriff at that time in Cherokee County, had come to the meeting, which law enforcement officers often did. That was good, making a relationship with their constituents in the county. And he was there, and my mother and dad said that he came to the altar that night. I don't know the extent of it or anything of that nature, but here was a man, a product of the time, of the Cooks and Hills, a man who understood getting to know the people that he represented as deputy sheriff or as sheriff, who came to a Brush Arbor meeting that was being held, and the country folk were all there in this meeting, and he came. This was a man of his time, a man who is often pictured as the kind of a fellow who would throw Kai Carlisle and Troy Love in the back of his car after they were shot on the Rice Carter farm out not too far from Standing Rock here in Cherokee County, and bring them into Tahlequah with their legs and arms flapping out and dump them on the ground in front of the Reed Culver Funeral Home. And perhaps that happened. I don't know. That's oral tradition. And Artie Morgan, in one of his books, did recount this. But there was another side to the man. And oral tradition is great. There's always a seed in oral tradition. But it does not necessarily mean that everything that you hear is really the true story.
On March 11, 1980, Bishop passed away. Even after being deceased for more than four decades, Bishop's name is mentioned almost as much as it was in his heyday as the no-nonsense lawman of Cherokee County. Bishop is buried alongside both of his wives in Sellers, Oklahoma, just down the road from his former farm.